Welcome, everyone. Welcome, welcome. Good afternoon. I am Dawn Monique Williams. I am a member of the board of directors for Playwrights Foundation. We want to welcome you all to this town hall event, deepening support for playwrights. I just checking to see who's here with us in the room. I want to let you know that today's session is being recorded for archival purposes. So if you do not want to be on the recording, then please keep your camera off. We will invite folks to participate with us today along in the chat. So feel free to drop any questions, comments, thoughts that you might be having in the chat. So let me make sure I'm not missing anything from the chat. Great. We will begin our session today with the Native Land Acknowledgement. We, Playwrights Foundation, respectfully acknowledge that our offices are on the unceded territory of the Ramaytush Ohlone, who are the past, present, and future caretakers of this land. We are guests here and recognize that we benefit from living and working on their ancestral homeland. It is a privilege to call this our home. We wish to pay our respects by acknowledging the ancestors, elders, and relatives of the Ramaytush community and by affirming their sovereign rights as First Peoples. If you are interested in donating or learning more about the Ramaytush Ohlone people and considering paying a land tax, we encourage you to check out this link at ramaytush.org/donate. Great. Now I would love to welcome our panelists for this afternoon. So I'm gonna pass the proverbial mic to each one of them and let them introduce themselves and share a little fun fact about their work. And I will start with Jessica.
Hi, thanks, Don. My name is Jessica Bird Beza. My pronouns are she, hers, and I'm the executive artistic director here at Playwrights Foundation, and so excited to be in community with all of you who are here in the space and or maybe watching this online later. Let's see. Oh, and I'm joining from the lands of the Mwekma Ohlone people. And let's see, a fun fact about myself and what I do. I'm also a director and producer as well. And one of the shows that I worked on before I came to Playwrights Foundation was working as associate director on Come From Away. So I'll throw that out there. And I'll pass the mic over to Lauren Gunderson.
Hi friends, Lauren Gunderson, she, her, hers. My needs are being met right now. I'm here with my cat who loves a Zoom meeting, so she will be making her appearance. I'm also here in San Francisco on Ohlone Ramaytush land. And fun facts about, I don't have a fun fact. I grew this plant from a tiny little leaf, so I'm quite proud of it. I feel like it's one of my babies. Evren.
Hi, everybody. Evren Odcikin, he, him, his. I'm calling in from Ashland, Oregon, the ancestral lands of the Shasta, Takama, and Latgawa peoples. I'm here. I'm a director, writer, and arts leader. My day job, I guess, is associate artistic director and director of artistic programming at Oregon Shakespeare Festival. The reason why I'm on this call is because I'm the treasurer of the board of directors at Playwrights Foundation. And it's an organization that I've had a very long, almost two decades, I would say, relationship with as a reader, volunteer, artist, director, Golden Thread Productions producing partner. So it's an organization that's very dear to my heart, and I'm excited to talk about all the things today. Fun fact, I'm a huge Lego enthusiast. So what keeps me going in this moment of, you know, some of the OSF stuff has been pretty public, high level stress is I make giant Legos to feel like I'm accomplishing something. that is very tangible, and I recommend it to everyone. I'll pass it to Adam.
I love that fun fact. I wish I would have done something non-theater. Thanks, Evren. I love that.
Yeah, thanks, Evren. That's a good tip. I don't think I've done a Lego set in at least 5 years. My kids kind of aged out of it, it seemed. So hi, everyone. I'm Adam Fong, he, him pronouns. I'm also calling in from San Francisco, Ramatush Ohlone land. And I am here on behalf of the Hewlett Foundation, where I am a program officer in the performing arts program. I've been in that role now for four and a half years, something like that. And fun fact, I am an artist. I am a musician by training. And before I joined Hewlett, was running a music organization called the Center for New Music. So hopefully that's a fun fact for other artists to hear, that although I am now working full-time as a funder, I still have my artistic practice. And I hope that that helps me do a better job being an arts funder.
Thank you, Adam. And I just wanna uplift Lauren's comment in the chat that Lauren is also a member of the Playwrights Foundation board, as well as an alum of several of their programs. This little tidbit of information will sort of be key in looking at the arc of the conversation today regarding deepening a commitment to playwrights. Again, I wanna invite you all to go ahead and feel free to introduce yourselves in the chat, type who you are and where you're calling in from. So Playwrights recently announced a sort of new purpose statement along with some clarifying vision and value statements. And that is what we are here to discuss today. So I'm gonna throw that back up on the screen. Dawn lies. No, now I am for real. Gonna throw that back up on the screen. I don't know why PowerPoint and Zoom do not wanna play nice today for me.
I feel like technology makes things easier and harder at the same time sometimes.
So I figured out the dance routine that it makes me do. As soon as I get this thing out of the way.
Yeah, and while you're doing that, I may just, as we move into talking about the purpose, vision, and values, and also kind of laid the foundation for the programming announcements that we also just announced as well. We're here.
We are here. Here is our new purpose statement. Our purpose is to support and empower playwrights' artistic growth and careers while championing their voices on a national level. That purpose is tied to this vision statement. We imagine a future where playwrights are radically centered as visionary leaders who transform the world through storytelling. And then we have this charming infographic that I love so much that is a sort of picture map of our values, where we have playwrights centered in the middle, and then some surrounding values, commitments, and things that we are focused on. And I would love to come back to you, Jessica, and just ask, you know, how we arrived at this reimagined purpose, vision, and values.
Yeah, thank you. I may also ask that we go back and look at the purpose. I'm just going to highlight some things in it. Because I think visually looking at this is helpful, and also it was a multi-year process. So I started at Playwrights Foundation in fall 2019, and we already kind of had a strategic planning process set up with Hewlett, funded by Hewlett, which is amazing because of the executive leadership transition. And then so many other things happened with COVID, you know, social justice uprisings that really impacted the work, and something that we thought might be 9 months turned into an 18-month process that was also just kind of revolutionary in terms of like, how do we deepen our support for playwrights and how do we radically center them in the process? And this purpose came out of that strategic planning process where we also had almost 50% playwrights, a lot of alumni who were involved in that as well. And this purpose really, I think, has been shifting us internally as an organization away from primarily focusing on new play development and focusing on the playwright as a whole and their artistic growth and careers, which is really kind of revolutionized, I think, how we look at things and how we look through things like through the lens of the values. But I'd also love to open it up to other folks on the panel of just kind of who Evren and Lauren were involved in the strategic planning process and have been on the board and kind of seeing how this has shifted the way we approach things as an organization as well. It's the dance of who wants to hop in first.
Yeah, I mean, I'll say that, you know, I tell the story that Jessica tricked me into taking part into the strategic planning process beautifully, as artistic directors do. I had no time, and she sort of, I was really excited by Jessica, your sort of early thinking about the kind of changes you felt like needed to happen as we were starting the listening process. So I stepped in, and then I will say the two things that were really exciting to me, that the room was filled with artists, both in terms of playwrights, of course, which is really important, but I'm a director, playwright. Dawn was there. We had a lot of sort of producing partners, the interviews I talked to because of my position at OSF, a lot of, I did a couple of the interview sessions for New Works producers who partner with Jessica, with Playwrights Foundation, or haven't, but we would like them to. And I just want to say I was really moved by the care that was taken in that info collecting process and the way that those data points actually were seeded into the full process. So that, and it makes sense to me that because the artists were so centered in it, that the purpose statement that came out of it feels larger and a lot more artist focused and playwright focused, of course, specifically. And the thing that gets me excited, and this is as an artist slash producer slash programmer slash whatever I am, is that this is sort of more focusing on the humanity of the playwrights and the full career and lives of the playwrights, as well as like this one play. Right, like that focus moving away from like, we're just gonna get this play developed to we're gonna actually help this playwright get to whatever the next spot is they need to get to, is such a holistic and helpful and humane way of going through this. Because, and I'll let Lauren, you know, speak as a playwright of the, you know, what it feels like to not be centered in development processes, which we've all been through those workshops. So I just felt very, very inspired, and inspired enough that Jessica twisted my arm and asked immediately after to join the board. And I said, yes. And then here I am now, I'm the treasurer of the board. So clearly, you know, good job, Jessica, great leadership skills of, you know, convincing people to keep leaning in. But also that's because I actually really, really personally believe that what Playwrights Foundation is trying to do is good and powerful and necessary. So that's sort of, I hope that's helpful as a, my, you know, sort of producer slash artist perspective, which is fun to sort of be in those both worlds and feel as inspired by this new purpose wearing both my hats.
Lauren, we of course want to hear from you, someone who came to San Francisco as a very early career playwright and has now made it your home and gone from being somebody who was, you know, in the festival to now sitting on the board and having been part of that strategic planning process.
Yeah. yes, I adore Playwrights Foundation. I always have. And it, all I can say is that it worked for me. I've been a part of almost all of the programs that they offer, and many of those plays, almost every single one, has gone on. And so I feel like I know what's working, but I also know that and what we try to hone and articulate in the planning process that then this is the result of is figuring out how do we serve lots of different writers in the ways that they are different. And there are things that I know and need for my process, and to have space in this new version for that process to be not just heard and kind of sort of adjusted, but to really say, what do you need? What is the thing that is most helpful? And then of course, to follow the playwright after the process. So whether that's Bay Area Playwrights Festival or the resident playwrights or any other partnerships and readings that come out, the reading isn't the end of the play and the work isn't the end of the work. So how do we use what we have in terms of our relationships, the team at Playwrights Foundation, and all of the collective wisdom and knowledge of our alumni and our board and everybody to help truly nurture, not just kind of say, thanks for the reading, good luck, let us know when you're on Broadway, but what do you actually need for what's next? And I'm excited. I also feel like we're at the beginning of this process. We know a lot to have gotten us here, but we will learn through the next years and decades to come about how to make this idea its best self. And so that I'm excited for that part as well, to be exactly where we are and where we want to be and need to be, and to keep learning from all of you who will apply and be a part of these programs.
Thank you. I'm going to advance us here to this next part of it, the vision. We imagine a future where playwrights are radically centered as visionary leaders who transform the world through storytelling. And I'm actually going to ask Adam, from a funder's perspective, I know that Hewlett is supporting playwrights through an organizational effectiveness grant. And I'm curious, like I said, from that funder's perspective, why this is an investment that Hewlett chose to support and how Playwrights is partnering with Hewlett to achieve this vision.
Sure. Thank you, Dawn. So the relationship between Playwrights and Hewlett predates me. As far as I can tell, the first grant that was given to Playwrights from Hewlett was actually 40 years ago, 1983. And Hewlett's been providing pretty much general operating support for all of that time. And then on top of that, we will occasionally do these sorts of organizational effectiveness grants. Sometimes people call them capacity building grants. So I think the one important thing to know is, like, when we supported the strategy process and the executive transition, we didn't know this is where the organization was going to land. You know, all we knew was that it was obviously a critical time of transition. A generational shift in leadership and lots of complicating factors in terms of what playwrights and theater companies have to deal with in the Bay Area and beyond. So the extra infusion of resources was really meant to allow the space and the time and the resources for Jessica and the board and the community to be able to go through this process, the strategic planning process, and, you know, look again at the mission, look again at the purpose, and think, what is the best way for us to lean into the resources and assets we have and provide the best service? So I'm, of course, really happy with where things have landed. But I think our support was not really conditioned on this vision being the one that came forth. It was really just to recognize that there was this critical moment going on with the organization, and that if we didn't provide something extra to create that room, the precarity of sort of running this very scrappy organization might actually get undermined by all of the challenges of, you know, saying goodbye to a longtime leader, welcoming a new one, trying to reinvigorate the board, trying to shift programs to better reflect the current environment. All of those things are extremely challenging. Not every executive transition is that way, but I think for playwrights, this was clearly a moment, and everyone on the board seemed to know that there were many questions that needed to be asked and that the process couldn't be rushed. So I'll just say that, and I think I'll leave it to the more well-informed and more visionary people to explain, like, how the process led to where things are at today.
Great, thank you so much. Jessica, I will swing back to you. That sort of covers a little bit of the, like, journey to, right? Deep strategic planning, a more robust process than I've been involved with in any other organization. including OSF, where I worked some time ago and did a strategic planning process. So I think now part of this announcement, right, is that we're in an implementation phase. So Jessica, say more about implementation and where we're at on that journey.
Yeah, I mean, I think these new purpose, vision, and values have really helped guide us in terms of implementation, and kind of, it's actually been like a culture shift too of what's happening, and not just, I think, at Playwrights Foundation, but I think in the field at large, in terms of like, how are playwrights and artists in general seen as leaders and not, you know, coming in to help? And we are here to help and support, but I think how some of that has shifted in terms of implementation is, you know, we use this phrase of like, how do we radically center our playwrights to get us out of the mindset, right, that we're either already doing it, but to like think outside of the box, and have begun to like develop more co-creative processes in which we're working with playwrights, asking more questions around what you need, having options. You know, trying to have some flexible models that says, here are resources, this is what we can do. What do you need? How can that be implemented? And I think we've invited more playwrights on our board. We have more playwrights on staff. We have been creating working committees in which we have playwrights as we've been making decisions. Even before we made this announcement, we brought together like alumni to talk about, this, and their like thoughts and feedback were implemented before we kind of moved forward and made the board decision. And I think these values in terms of implementation, one of the reasons we created these infographic is because we're like, how are these values just not like definitions that sit, you know, on our website, but like, how are we actively using these? And we reflect on these in staff meetings, we reflect on these in board meetings, and use these questions, you know. And I think one of the exercises we do that I may just invite us to do as we're looking at this is in terms of like, oh, looking at this and resonating, what are we doing well? And where do we have room to grow? And so we're doing that weekly. With these questions, you know, and I think the question around empowering playwrights with more agency, that's one of the reasons the word empower became into our, the purpose, is because there's so many times I ask questions of playwrights and they're like, no one's ever asked me that question. And the power hasn't been like put in their court to be able to make decisions on things. And so I think that's, we've been wanting to move things in that direction. And, you know, I think just looking at this one example, transparency in this process, this town hall is an example of transparency that we're trying to put into place, of giving some behind the scenes, just more the story behind the announcement, because there's so much behind what is happening and why we're shifting our programs. And I may invite anybody, you know, Lauren, Evren, Adam, or Don, you know, just looking at these values, I think how you've seen them put into practice, or how we have been growing through these, or how they have been, you know, helpful in the guidance as we've been moving forward. So let me just open it up for either of you to be like, oh yeah, how are these being put into practice?
I mean, I can jump in. I think I'm just going to jump right into the middle. The idea of, we've said this a lot, what does playwright-centered mean? And it actually comes from, again, just the simple question of asking the writers, instead of presuming what we know, presuming what we think is best, presuming what they want. Do you want this production ready? Or is that even not where you're actually ready? That's not what you're actually trying to do. You're trying to get the idea into the air as opposed to on Broadway. You know, those can be different questions. So that's a strange example, but you know what I mean? So the idea of really every one of these colors that you see, again, the middle is the point. So when we talk about inclusion, well, what does that mean to be inclusive and playwright-centered, the local commitment and playwright-centered? So it feels very grounding and centering in the idea that you always have to ask the writers, and many of us know writers very well. And even me, what is playwright? It's not Lauren's version of playwriting centered. It is every playwright's that we encounter, that we engage with, that we support, it is that they have to be at the center of their own version of this, which is a radical thought, because we kind of want to go, yeah, we get it. This is close enough for most writers. This will work fine, as opposed to engaging every single step of the way with what is helpful to each writer and what they mean by community and transparency and innovation, and having that change and absorb and alter what we think of those things.
What I love about this current moment, I just want to name that we are having this conversation of, as it says here, like an abundance mindset conversation in the context of a field that is in crisis, specifically like American theater in general, but specifically the new work development space, where we lost so many of our various different really key organizations, or people have had to step back in really big ways. And I feel like, to be pretty transparent in this room, there was a period where, as we were thinking about these changes, the response, or even the sort of early worry about it, was that it was less, right? That, like, because we've all been conditioned so much about more is more, more, we got to do more, we got to push more. Even if we have $2, we got to pretend like we have 10 and figure out how to serve $10 worth of people on $2. And it feels so helpful to actually figure out what we do, which is that support playwrights' processes and careers, and then really be intentional in even our consideration of programs, or frequency of programs, or process creation, as Jessica, you said, about responsiveness to what a playwright needs, a specific playwright. Think about our community outreach and our audience building around each play and each playwright's, or each program's, specific purpose and mission and needs. And that kind of having something quite as robustly and clearly stated, and then also activated in the decision making, is not, that's actually pretty rare. And it's been pretty exciting to be part of those conversations and feel like we're holding each other accountable to the values and the purpose that we are putting out there, right? And what's so interesting about it is, of course, as it happens with the abundance mindset, as we feel like, okay, we're gonna do this program less frequently, all of a sudden capacity opens up to serve more playwrights in other ways. So it doesn't even end up being less in the long run, right? It actually ends up being deeper and more, but it's important that I feel like American theater arts, nonprofit arts, within the context of a capitalist society, have been in a very, very specific hamster wheel for decades. And this is true for producing organizations, certainly true for, you know, any organization that's within the arts field. And I'm excited for, you know, Playwrights Foundation, one of the places that's like, we're gonna get off this wheel and actually figure out how we do the thing we say we do, and listen to the people that we're gonna serve, and see if we can be responsive to what they're actually saying. And I find that there's a lot of lip service to that kind of process. But as Dawn said, like, I agree, having been through God knows how many strategic processes in my, you know, 20-year career, this not only felt good, but I actually felt like we were doing the thing we said. And that accountability, as you said, Lauren, I feel very strongly that Playwrights Foundation staff and board has an ongoing commitment to that kind of accountability. So yeah, like, we're gonna try these ideas, we're gonna put it out there, we're gonna have town halls like this and expand the circle of input, and then we will iterate, right? We will thoughtfully and specifically iterate according to our findings. And that, that just does all the things that's on this page. You know what I mean? That actually centers all the things: transparency, equity, inclusion, community, local commitment, and innovation. That's the only way to do that. And I feel, yeah, it's really, I feel proud to be on the board for Playwrights Foundation for many reasons, but that sort of accountability and ongoing commitment to the purpose as stated, and the humans, I will say, that's like a big thing for me. Achieving things on the back of people is not really working for us anymore. And that commitment to not do that anymore is really powerful. And it makes me excited to be like on the board on this panel, sing Playwrights Foundation's praises in public, you know?
Excellent segue, Evren, in terms of some of the implementation steps that we at Playwrights have taken. I love that Adam used the term capacity building. And one of the things that came up for us often in the strategic planning process was before we could build capacity, we had to first sort of right size. And in order to be radically playwright centered, we had to also think about the stuff that wasn't like public facing, like staff and making staff whole. So over the past few years, these are some of the ways we've put our values into action. We've increased playwright agency and leadership and artistic decisions at all levels of the organization. Lauren is with us today. She is not the only playwright on the board. There are others. Many playwrights were part of the stakeholder interviews we did as part of the strategic planning process, and other playwrights were part of the strategic planning task force. There's been an increase of wages for all staff and artists. And we'd like to build more capacity there. We've eliminated unpaid internships and free artistic labor. We are creating more year-round part-time staff positions and increasing diversity amongst board and staff. I am a new board member, having just joined the board a few months back, even though I was part of the strategic planning task force. Oh gosh, that was like a year and a half ago at this point. Jessica, Evren, Lauren, are there anything you want to add about these bullet points? Anything you want to highlight in terms of the steps we've already taken to put our values into action?
It's just awesome.
Maybe I can jump in here.
Yes.
And just say, I mean, I think something that's really powerful in what you said, Dawn, about right-sizing is that we know that particularly running an organization in the Bay Area means you have to deal with the escalating costs that have happened in the last decade. And that's something that for us at the foundation, we know all of our grantees are facing that. The pandemic, of course, put everyone on a roller coaster for what that meant in terms of who's on staff and, you know, how much can you pay people and where can they live and where do they want to live? But the core problem is still there. And I think as we're seeing now, even if the, media wants to portray something different as happening, it's not like the cost of living in the Bay Area is going down. So these are like obviously long-term problems that have accumulated pressure on organizations for years and years. And I think what's really exciting about this to me is none of this says we're increasing wages by X amounts, right? It's all intentionally framed in a sense that these improvements are based on principles clearly that can respond to different economic environments. So like if the pressure continues to build in the Bay Area, you have a set of language that kind of puts your principles in place and allows you to be able to react and respond to those challenges. So I think when we think about like labor movements that are asking for particular things, those are moments in time when those numbers make sense. But the really important change and what's really a true capacity building shift, in my opinion, is knowing what the principle is for how you're going to respond to that ongoing pressure or that ongoing challenge, whether it's, increased cost of living or that people want to live somewhere and work somewhere else, or they're only available at particular times of day. Like all of these things are defining factors in how we set up our lives and the ways that we realize who we want to be. So it's so important for the organization, I think, to know how it wants to relate to people and what standards it's going to hold up for itself.
Thank you, Adam. That's really good.
Oh, sorry.
I was just affirming Adam.
I think going back to that page just real quick, and I realized like looking at this and like what we've done, I've needed people like Evren and Don and Lauren are the people on the board to say, we are doing this, because I'm always looking at it being like, we're not doing enough yet. And sometimes I need the board to be like, hey, we actually are moving in this direction, because I look at this and have to be like, and this started in 2020 before the pandemic, you know, came, of trying to start right sizing the organization. And I'm like, we want to keep doing that. And every single year we have built in, how are we increasing the wages, you know, every year? It hasn't been like a big jump. And even the free artistic labor, we started paying all of our readers, but it is not enough yet, you know? So now I'm at this place that I'm like, okay, how do I go out and get more funding to do more of even these points, right? Like, it's not just oh, we're there yet, we're done. It's like, nope, this is something we're like working towards every single year. And I realize I'm like inspired. I continue to get like inspired and like accountable, just even in this conversation of like, yeah, it's, we're laying the foundation for how we want to keep moving forward in the values. So yeah, I'm like feeling inspired and also like want to keep going out and get more money from more foundations so we can do more of this. That's like the next step.
So these are the program model changes that we've announced, and this is how we feel we're going to be putting our purpose into action. It allows us to increase the amount of time, care, and resources to the Bay Area Playwrights Festival and our resident playwrights. The Bay Area Playwrights Festival will shift from an annual festival to a biennial hybrid festival. This will expand the pre-festival program from 4 months to 12. The 46th Bay Area Playwrights Festival public readings will be held April 12th through 24th, 2024. So this actually will allow the playwrights a longer runway, a longer developmental process that's really sort of curated for their specific needs and kind of guided by what they want, what they need. The residence playwrights program will shift from a 4-year to a 2-year residency. Public presentations of new work will occur in the second year of residency, alternating years with BAPF public readings. Applications will open to San Francisco Bay Area writers in July of 2023 for a 2024 to 2025 residency. And we are sunsetting the rough readings program in partnership with the National Center for New Plays at Stanford University. This was sort of our big announcement. And Jessica, do you want to speak more to what the intended impact of this program change is?
Yeah, I mean, I think what I keep telling people is each of these programs needed a little bit of what the other one had. And so that is some of what we're almost doing. Is the festival used to get like the lion's share of the attention in the organization and was so quick, like so quick, you know, like a month and a half of kind of doing everything in prep before you get to the festival. And it made it really hard to be responsive. And now that I've like done this 3 years, I'm like, that's not, you know, where we're going and what we want to do. In addition to the resident playwrights, when I came in, there were 10 resident playwrights. There's only one full-time person at Playwrights Foundation, and I want to like say that. And so it's like really hard to give the time and intentional care as we move into this deepened model. So it's looking at, you know, how is there more artistic growth and like career goals and like networking in the festival, and there's three sections with the festival now, in which like you come 9 months and start with a retreat instead of 2 weeks before, and then have a virtual table read, and then the festival plus like cohort meetings and all of these different things. I'm going to put into the chat, we did a town hall about BAPF and kind of broke down the specifics of it. So I'm not going to go too much into detail, but it's just about how is there more like overall playwright support? And yes, we're like helping them create this play. And then the resident playwright program is really one of our most impactful programs that people don't know about. And, you know, looking at moving that to a 2-year residency and supporting 4 or 5 playwrights in that 2-year residency, we've deepened, we just kind of like had our last cohort that was 5 playwrights. And through that process, by having less playwrights, we're able to we've done like a 600% increase of like how much money is just going directly to them, which, you know, I say that percentage, even though it went from like $400 a year to $200 a month. But my dream is like, how is that 20,000 a year? You know? So I think that's the thing where I'm like, okay, how do we right size this to be able to give more? And often resident playwrights weren't, there's multiple that came out of the residency without having a public presentation, unless they were in the festival or a rough reading. And so how do we brand something that is highlighting our resident playwrights and giving them that in the process, which will happen in the year opposite the festival? So we will still be doing multiple things. It just won't always be the festival, which I think is really exciting. And yeah, so I think that's some of the details behind what those are, but also how there's the combination of artistic growth and the like public aspect of it, which many playwrights want, and how we can help elevate them on a national scale, which is with having something public. And so I'll stop there and see if anybody else wants to talk about kind of the direction of the new programs.
And I also invite folks, if they have thoughts or questions, to go ahead and drop them in the chat.
It's like, who's going to talk next? When you just open it up.
Well, I, for one, am really excited about the programmatic shifts, because I think the deeper investment over time for the BAPF is a really great model. Having directed plays and built relationships with the writers that I've worked with as a result of that, for it, the festival itself for a director felt like a lot like a smash and grab. And so I think this is so great for the playwrights to have a 12 month sort of lead up to be able to have conversations with you and the staff, Jessica, and for you to do that like great matchmaking of allowing them to like talk to different directors and build those relationships. I think it's really a great thing.
Maybe I can ask a question, and this is going to be a hard one. So it's open to any of you, I think, who were involved in this process. Jessica mentioned how the strategy process was extended due to the pandemic, and then it also happened in the context of racial justice uprisings and extended conversations within our local community about how the theater sector needed to change. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about how you believe those conversations with your peers in the field impacted what we're seeing today. Is there a direct connection in your mind between, say, the accountability work that I know was happening for many theater companies, the racial justice protests we saw on the street, the financial precarity that the pandemic really brought forth? I know all those things were inevitable, probably topics of discussion, but I'm wondering if there are particular ways that you see those things revealed in the strategy that you're putting forth here.
I will say, in a bit of a moment of vulnerability / bravery, you know, I've been an artist at Playwrights Foundation and saw firsthand the ways in which previous processes or approaches had been harmful to folks. So I found it really clarifying that there was a lot of conversation with past participants to be able to not just get to the problems so we can solve them, but like really honest. And we sort of set it up, I say we, like I did it, we as the people who were running the process, set it up so that there were one-on-one conversations as well as group conversations. And there was a lot of ways to get real specific information about what parts of the processes or the way we were approaching the stated purpose might be harmful. And in the context of everything else that was going on in the world, not just within, you know, we see white American theater and some of the more specific theater related, you know, revolution moment that we went through, but also just in the world in general, I was really thankful, I will say. I think it's such a gift. Like that document itself was such a gift to all theater makers and theater producers or artistic leaders, but also it, I think, allowed people to be braver to actually share their experiences. I will say I was on the receiving end of a couple of those conversations as part of this, you know, the committee. And I think it was really great that people felt comfortable and brave. And, you know, it's labor to do that, to have to tell you about what happened is actual real labor. And it was really clear that people were doing that with the idea that we were committed to fixing it forward. And I just want to say, none of those experiences felt, everything is unique, but also it was in the context of all new play development and all new play, you know, like it was actually sad to feel like, oh, I've heard that so many times. And when we brought it into the committee, rather than getting stuck in the like, who did what and the, you know, like kind of getting to that place, I felt like the, equity and the, you know, access conversations got real centered. And I'll like pull out Dawn as someone in those conversations that would always sort of make sure that whatever we were talking about was also including. Because the thing that I find exciting is, although we named equity as a very separate and specific thing that needed to be addressed, I think we got real clarity in the committee as we worked through that process that every conversation has to include it. Like, it's not a siloed, separate conversation. The work conversation has to be about the work, you know? So I just feel like that felt really well handled. And again, it's just such an iterative moment in our field right now that I'm really excited by the very stated purpose that we're putting out there and how access and equity is really centered and is a very big part of it. But I do think that section is going to be in the doing. Like, we'll see, you know, like, again, that list that we put up, freaking great. Again, as Lauren said, I'm like, yes, you know, I'm so excited that that lists of achievements are real. But the real, real sort of process and human-centered change that's happening, we're continuing. And I see the folks at Playwright's Ambition, because the staff holds this in such a great way. They're really focused on it, and it feels authentic and real and committed in a way that, again, like I'm curious what we're gonna learn, because that's just a, you know, there's no end to that work, if that makes sense.
Thank you, Evren.
I may hop in, and I think, you know, just thinking about, and thank you for sharing, you know, some of that, Evren, because there has been a culture shift in Playwrights Foundation that is reflective of the culture shift that is happening nationally. You know, I think that is what we are really dedicated to. And I feel a responsibility every day, and also recognizing that we're still human, you know? And I think for me, how do we have a human-centered approach so when harm does happen, you're not moving past it, but we're like being in relationship with it and trying to heal in the moment and have, you know, processes that are set up. Because I think the thing even for me is like, I'm always trying to be like, okay, what's the systems, what's the processes, so maybe harm doesn't happen. And I've come to this realization that all of us are humans. So even the artists that are in the room, you know, like things happen, even if it's an all, you know, even if it's a non-white space. And so I think I've just been realizing like, oh, I don't actually have the power to make sure that harm doesn't happen, but how do we create a culture in which we are leading with our values and using those as things, you know, to be able to have open conversations and inviting people into the spaces, you know, and that like keep us accountable. And I think that's some of the shift that's happened as we've, yeah, had more robust systems around having like reflective and evaluative processes throughout as we're moving through staff, board, and with artists. But yeah, I just feel like a deep commitment and accountability to just like how we live into these and surrounded. I think we're surrounding ourselves with more people who are committed to that, like just with Don, Evren, and Lauren being on the board and seeing like, I can't do this alone. And I think we're building a stronger team to be able to do that. And all of our conversations with leaders across deeply impacted, I think, what we were doing. There's no way for it like not to, because I think we were all changing as individuals over these past few years also. So yeah, that's what I may offer to that great question, Adam.
Thank you, Jessica. Friends and supporters, we are nearing our hour. There were a couple of things in the chat that I just want to uplift, that there was some affirmation that increasing development time from 4 months to 12 months is really wonderful, and that this work sounds like the product of intentional dreaming. I want to thank you all for being with us this afternoon. For anyone that joined us late, this will be recorded. That recording will be available. So thank you all for being interested in the work that we're doing. We are dropping a survey in the chat. We'd love it if you could take a couple minutes to fill that out so that we can continue to widen our circle of engagement. I believe Evren said that earlier. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining us.
Yes, thank you. And thank you, Don, for directing our conversation today. Appreciate it.
Happy to be here. Very happy to be here.